Miseri Giacomo, alive and well. Your presence here is proof that my gift was delivered successfully, and that you knew how to use it in the best possible way. You did not disappoint me, which is, as you will soon see, a good thing for you. I'm sure you're asking yourself the obvious question of why the mysterious man before you has even helped you to your freedom. Well, above all, I do not pay heed to the unlikely tales of witchcraft and occultism those blind fanatics accused you of. If they had their way, we would all be flung several centuries into the past. However, I do believe in the power of knowledge. I like to support able and well-educated people. You, of course, counted among them, Giacomo. I know your work and your skills, and I can find a good use for them. But I am, as you are surely beginning to understand, an extremely powerful man. As easily as I was able to get you out of that prison, I can put you back with just a wave of the hand and leave you there to rot. It's your choice. This is my offer. You may choose to return to your foul-smelling cell in Castello Estense, which would, of course, be unexpected, or decide to enter my service instead. In which case you could finally make full use of your exceptional skills. But let us return to my principal issue. As I stated, I am currently supporting a number of artists and inventors, all of whom work for me with gratitude, but one of the greatest minds of our time still eludes me. I am certain you already know of him. Messere Leonardo da Vinci. He is currently staying in Milan, seeking assistance for his scientific work. Every candidate for this post must first complete a complex test to show that he can be beneficial to the master's research. No one has proven successful so far, but you, Giacomo, could be the right one. It will be in your own best interests, if you understand my meaning. You will complete Leonardo's test, enter his services, and while keeping up appearances, you will secretly inform me of his every move. You will also ensure that in the end, the only employer of Leonardo da Vinci will be me, Cesare Borgia. Take this notebook. You will secretly record every detail of your investigation in it. You will report to me and keep me informed. You will find Master Leonardo in the Church of Santa Maria della Grazia, where he addresses himself to some grandiose painting. One of my reliable people will take you to Milan. You should be on your way. And Giacomo, do not fail me. There is one more thing. As a soldier, I am accustomed to almost any hardship. But Messere Leonardo is, after all, a man of considerable delicacy and refinement. Before you meet him, you should not forgo a thorough bath and change of clothing.
To tell the truth, I did not expect another to take on my challenge, but I'm pleased to see that in the end another brave soul decided to try. Well, I was told that your name is Giacomo, so I bid you welcome. You just entered the labyrinth, and your task is simple. You need to find your way to the other side. I, of course, put a few little obstacles in your path. But if you will be careful and diligent in your search, Giacomo, I'm sure you will prevail. That is all I will say for now. Well, I suppose I should wish you, like I wished all those before you, good luck, and more importantly, an open mind. If you prove to me that you are worthy to be my apprentice, I will meet you again on the other side of the labyrinth.
Thank you. another interruption. I told you clearly that... Oh, is that you?
I'm sorry. When I'm immersed in my work, I tend to forget the world around me. I thought that they sent me another letter from the abbot in which he will ask me for yet another time, when will the mural be ready? As if he had no idea that his constant questioning will not speed up the process at all. Ah, very interesting. I must confess, I am surprised. You see, many before you who failed my challenge assured me that it was impossible. Therefore, I must admit that you made a great impression on me. In any case, I am glad that it will be you who will enter my services. There is much work before us, and I believe that in you I am gaining a very capable ally. Let us tarry no longer, and start working right away. What do you say, Giacomo?
Was quite clear, Master. Enough! This was the last insult. You, Leonardo, have no idea what pressure I am under. I cannot wait any longer. I will gladly double your commission, but I need the machine finished as soon as possible.
I am sorry, sir, but no amount of money can speed up the process.
As I was saying, just finish it.
Oh, Giacomo, you are here. Excellent. Look what we have here. In the morning, I was visited by a Valencian nobleman whose name I have unfortunately forgotten, and who told me he has received this peculiar thing from his guest, a certain Turkish seafarer. He asked me to find out what is hidden inside this particular cabinet. Naturally, I tried to explain that I'm currently working on more pressing matters, but in the end, he persuaded me by telling me that I am the only one who can help him. To tell the truth, the financial reward he offered was even stronger motivation, as we will certainly need money. I very much doubt that there is anything extraordinary or even dangerous hidden inside. Even though the Duke... The gentleman acted as if he thought that the devil himself is in there. Well, as I was saying, I currently do not have the time to cater to whims of some nobleman. You will take on this task, Giacomo, and I will come back when you are finished to see what you have discovered. How are you proceeding, Giacomo? Well, I see you are on the right path. Now I must finish something in the upper workshop, so you continue here. I would expect to see the cabinet's mechanism in all its beauty today. Fine work, Giacomo. As I predicted, nothing dangerous. It looks like some kind of clockwork mechanism on which the Turkish seafarer, devil knows why, depicted his voyager's discoveries. His fellow countrymen must have admired the ingenuity, skill, and care needed to construct such a mechanism. It is definitely a precious gift. I am sure our client will be more than happy. Oh, I'm tired after such a long day. I will head to my chamber to lie down. You, Giacomo, clean up the workshop. When you're finished, go and rest as well.
Surprised to see me? I realize that it has been quite a few days since our last meeting, and perhaps you even thought to be forgotten. Isn't that right? But I do not forget, Giacomo. I came to remind you of the debt you still owe. It is time to make a payment. I know you still remember the circumstances of your release, and what you agreed to do for me. The notebook. You are in luck. It seems that I did not come in vain. But beware. Your work for Master Leonardo is not finished yet. Do not forget why you are here and keep your silence. Leonardo cannot know anything about any of this.
You have no idea how glad I am to see you, dear friend. 13 long years have passed before we finally meet again, Giacomo. You seem surprised. But if you looked carefully at what I left you on the mechanical table up in the tower, you must already understand. Everything that happened, happened simply because it was part of my plan. Actually, to tell the truth, the fact that Borgia came through the gate with you was unexpected. But even then, we gained a head start over those dangerous people. We now... I will tell you the details on the way. Giacomo, I need your help now more than ever before. But we cannot delay a moment longer. Time is not on our side. Too many stairs. I remember, Giacomo, that there were times when I set off for long walks through the steep hills around Milano in search of an inspiration for my painting of the Virgin of the Rocks. Although I was a lot younger at the time. But we are here for something completely different. The abbot of this monastery generously allowed us to visit the library and to study some of the books. My plan is to feign studying them and thus give you some time. In the meantime, you will try to locate the secret part of the library Luca Pacioli told me about. Somewhere in it, there must be the chronicle Ordo Iustitialis. I was told by the abbot that Brother Malachi, who serves within these walls as a librarian, should expect us. Now, go and knock upon the door so he knows we have arrived.
Laudetur Jesu Christus. You must be the honored Messere Leonardo da Vinci. I'm Malachi from Hildesheim. Father Abbot bestowed upon me the duty to show you around the library. Thus I welcome you, and please follow me. In this scriptorium, our transcribers, illuminators, and bookbinders work day after day to transcribe and translate the greatest treasures of the Christian world, as well as the works of masters of the classical antiquity. My brothers have just gone to their evening prayers. Therefore, you can devote yourselves to the study of the book you chose without any disturbances. The book is ready on the lectern. In case you need me, I will be meditating in our chapel.
Good. We are alone. You should now look for the secret part of the library. Seek anything strange or suspicious. Whatever will catch your eye. Giacomo, we have to work quickly now. Do not worry. If anyone comes, I will divert their attention.
you must focus on your task. Understand me?
In the year 1212 since the birth of Christ, Friedrich, the only son of Heinrich Stauffer, to his father's glorious throne arose. By providence chosen, though only 16 years old, clever and strong, he was a king most bold. Challenges were plentiful, but his judgments full of wisdom. Soon many a vassal, duke, or lord swore fealty to his kingdom. Monarch Roger, a patron to the erudite and all the wise men, every scholar, no matter the faith, was welcomed to his realm. His deeds were glorious. His subjects loved him more and more. His dominion prospered like never before. Soon the rumors were spread from the east to the west about Roger, the ruler of Christians, by God himself blessed. This praise reached Pope Gregory, but he froze, irked by hearing of another man as one God chose. Gregory's envy would lead to consequences most dire. No living soul could save Friedrich from his ire. With excommunication being his only other fate, Roger rode to Palestine on a crusade to save his state. Even with his most trusted knights, a dangerous proposition. Journey long, perilous and exhausting, a truly risky mission. Many a good man dead due to illness or fatigue, that was the true terror of the Pope's intrigue. One day a desert storm came, raged and refused to wane, threatening to end both their lives and the campaign. It seemed that for the Emperor's army, all hope was lost. Sentries were ordered to find shelter, no matter the cost. At the last moment, the group's scouts spotted a cave. Though ominous and sinister, they must choose to be brave. Roger's men entered the grotto with uneasy feel, making camp in surroundings that were most unreal. Days went by, the storm unwavering, no sign it would clear. Friedrich and his chosen explored their shelter without fear. Delving deeper into their shelter, anything but small, dark passages lined by pillars receded to a large hall. Friedrich and his company were men loyal and seasoned, but in their hearts was dread which could not be reasoned. Architecture meant not for living men, vast and bold, perhaps chiseled by some mysterious giants of old. Distracted from his reverie by a glimmer of light, Roger saw a part of metal buried in the sand upright. A machine, a gate, centuries old, with it he must return. What trove of lost knowledge from it could he learn? Friedrich, albeit short on time, researched that device. Its power to grant wisdom should more than suffice. Gate to the Temple of Wisdom, the device was now called. It would lead to understanding of deep truths unequaled. In much higher spirits, knights loaded the gate on the caravan, and once again their journey, their crusade has begun. The dread lifted, resolve firmer than ever before, no longer fearful of what for them lay in store. No more was the journey punishment meant by the Pope. Now their quest was meaningful, their hearts full of hope. In the end, Roger gained control of Jerusalem without blood spilt, opened the Holy Land to pilgrims again, defensive walls rebuilt. City's crown rested on Emperor's noble head, with wise Sultan Al-Kamil he shared his bread. People sang only praise for their emperor once again. With glory and magnificence, he continued his reign. Through the gate to the Temple of Wisdom, Friedrich often went. To learn its secrets, to further knowledge was his lustrous intent. He worked closely with those most loyal, those he chose. Thus, a new order of Knights Noble, Order of Justice, arose. Emperor Friedrich, always at their point, titled Grand Master, felt he did enough to sate Pope's anger, averted disaster. But to Gregory's ears were whispered rumors terrible, stories about a deal with the devil and lies unbearable, about how Roger's order was built to conceal a devil's gift, and since the Pope believed it, it caused an irreparable rift. Not long before the Emperor was excommunicated, by all the people of faith, he was to be isolated. Residents of Jerusalem, who just a year ago called him their savior, now cast him out, the Pope to blame for this behavior. The Emperor by this iniquity was aback taken. All the Pope's intrigues left him quite shaken. When he finally retreated to Italy and his throne, he lived for his order of justice and his land alone. Roger guarded the secrets of the order, for his enemies would not cease, wanted the gate more than secure, no longer believing in peace. A plan born both from his genial mind and godly inspiration. To build a fortress for the order, to be held in awe by the whole nation. To the castle's construction, he devoted his life. 8 massive walls to survive any strife. 8 watchtowers with windows peering over the countryside. Eternally guarded by 8 men most loyal and eagle-eyed. 8 sides to the courtyard for the men to meet and rest. In the middle of it all, an 8-sided podium protected best. On this podium, the gate to the Temple of Wisdom was erected. By all the knights, not to be worshipped, but to be respected. So it was created. For both the lost and the wise, it did shine. Templum Justitia, the Temple of Justice, the castle, the shrine. It was quarters of the order by the wise Placentinus foretold. Inside were troves of wisdom and power, more precious than gold. Even for the wise and powerful flies the time. Men became old, children rose to their prime. After the death of Roger, Grand Master first, others came, best of the order, in wisdom versed. One after another silent, hidden, but each of virtue measure, the gate to the Temple of Wisdom, always their treasure. Generation after generation, the secret was keeping, wealth and wisdom gaining, never relenting, never sleeping. But the year 1465 after Christ came, and for the order of justice, the world was never the same.
There he is! Look up! In the window, across the room! Get him!